Gene therapies are the most expensive drugs in the world, and that is because producing a viral vector for in vivo gene therapy is arguably the most complicated process ever attempted at scale in biopharmaceuticals. In a prior video, I talked about the Chinese hamster's revolutionary impact on scaling antibody manufacturing. Today, let's double-click on that. Hate this phrase. In this video, we look at the history and complex manufacturing issues of viral vector gene therapy. The goal is simple yet difficult. We need to transfer genetic material to a target cell so we can add, suppress, or edit a gene. The vehicles for delivering those genes are called vectors. Vectors used in early gene transfer experiments did not involve viruses. In 1962, the Polish-American scientist Vaclav Silbaski and colleague Elizabeth Silbaska pioneered a method of gene transfer for an experiment to see whether mammalian cells can pass down foreign genes to the next generation. These cells, part of the famous HeLa line, were not expected to pick up the naked genes because both the gene and cell membranes were negatively charged. By adding positively charged calcium ions to the DNA, reduced its negative charge enough to enter the cell. We call this method calcium phosphate co-precipitation, and in the 1970s and 1980s, it was widely used as a vector in a laboratory setting, and it's still sometimes used there today. But it was impractical for gene therapy treatments in vivo, meaning or within the human body. It's inefficient, even in a lab setting, where you can control the temperature and acidity, plus with the cell targets being right there. Inside the body, however, there is no targeting mechanism, so getting the naked gene to the right cells is laughably hard. The DNA is physically fragile and apt to deteriorate in the unstable blood or tissue environment. Not to mention that calcium phosphate can trigger immune responses or clump together, causing harm to the patient. So we needed something else, and viruses emerged as the best option, though research continues on non-viral vectors. We have known that viruses can pick up and carry genes since the early 1950s. In 1952, Norton Zinder and Nobel Prize winner Joshua Lederberg published the results of an experiment discovering that certain very small particles can move traits between populations of Salmonella bacteria. Due to the agent's tiny transistor-like size and hardiness to antibacterials, they concluded that it was a virus. They named this whole process transduction. The idea of modifying such viruses to carry healing genes was first publicly and seriously forwarded in a 1966 speech by Nobel Prize winner Edward Tatum. In it, he said, "Isolated DNA as such is physically taken up and integrated into the recipient bacterial genome in the transformation process or in transduction, is transferred from one bacterium to another by a virus, followed by integration. If this can be done successfully with animal cells, it will facilitate the development of a mammalian somatic cell genetics. It will also bring us considerably closer to successful genetic engineering." In the late 1960s, there were questions about whether it was possible, but evidence piled up to show that viruses can indeed be made to pick up, deliver, and inject genes into cells. But researchers using these virus vectors also have many considerations to take into account. How large of a gene can it carry? Can it target the right cells? What is its efficiency in delivering its genes to that target? How long do we want the gene effects to last? And above all, how safe is it for humans? The first human trials with gene viral therapies took place in the mid-1970s. Two girls in a West German village had been born with a serious and extremely rare genetic defect. Their bodies cannot produce an enzyme known as arginase, which breaks down a chemical called arginine. Too much arginine causes seizures and mental retardation. A professor at Oak Ridge Lab named E. Stanfield Rogers had been working with a virus called the Schoep papillovirus. Rabbits infected with the virus grow these scary-looking horns out of their faces and necks. But it also appeared to cause these rabbits to produce elevated amounts of a different type of arginase. Lab workers accidentally infected with the virus also showed results implying the same. Rogers deduced that the virus was injecting genes into the cells to make them produce more arginase, so he proposed to deliberately inject these girls with the Shope virus. Considering the circumstances, it was allowed. Unfortunately, the trial failed, only creating a severe but temporary allergy in one of the children. Later sequencing of the virus's genome found that it did not have a gene for producing arginase in humans. It is suspected that the effects seen in both human and rabbit stem from a heightened immune response to the virus. The first gene therapy quote-unquote success came over a decade later, in 1990. In September 1990, the FDA approved the first gene therapy trial for a therapeutic effect. Two girls suffered a serious immune disorder called severe combined immunodeficiency, or SCID, due to a deficiency in adenosine deaminase. The disorder is more widely known as Bubble Boy Syndrome, after the famous case of David Vedder, though I find such a name somewhat distasteful. For a long time, infants with this deficiency died within the first 2 years of life. Now, a new enzyme therapy has allowed patients to somewhat recover enough of a normal life, but a team led by Michael Blaise sought to permanently treat the condition with a retrovirus-based genetic treatment. Blaise's team extracted T-cells from the girls and then used a disabled Meloni-Marine leukemia retrovirus to inject new genes into those cells in the lab. After that, the cells were injected back into the girls' marrow. The girls received multiple infusions of these modified T-cells over the span of 2 years. After 5 years, the results showed that one of the girls showed a recovery in T-cell count, the other minimal effects. Neither patient suffered any serious negative side effects. It is hard to say whether the genetic therapy actually worked. The patient in question, Ashanti De Silva, had also received the enzyme therapy throughout the gene treatment. Which one deserves the credit? Hard to say. Nevertheless, the experiment was seen as a major step forward, opening the door to other trials of gene therapies for SCID. These early therapies used retroviruses. Retroviruses are RNA viruses that can inject DNA copies of their genomes into the host cell using an enzyme called reverse transcriptase. Retroviruses were initially chosen because of how they can insert genes into a cell's genome, but the industry soon moved away from them for several reasons. First, they can only target dividing cells because those are most vulnerable to intrusion. This basically limited retroviral gene therapies to stem cells, like for the aforementioned T cells for SCID. There are also other concerns regarding safety. Retroviruses are very potent at encoding their data into the cell genome. Too much so, as it turns out. You run the risk of something called insertional mutagenesis, where a gene insertion can disrupt other genes or even activate cancer-causing genes called oncogenes. A major 2008 paper looked at 10 patients who received gene therapy for SCID. 9 of the treatments were successful, but 4 of the 9 patients unfortunately developed leukemia a few years after the treatment. Adenoviruses seem like a high potential virus vector to replace the retroviruses. Adenoviruses are big double-stranded viruses. They infect a wide variety of animals and cause something ranging from the common cold to gastroenteritis to stuff much more serious. There is a lot about adenoviruses that made them more amenable to gene therapy. They are far larger, so they can hold a great deal more genetic data. 36,000 base pairs of DNA compared to 8,000 or so with the retroviruses. And cells don't have to be dividing to be infected, expanding the range of targets. And on the mutation risk, genes injected into the cell by the adenoviruses remain episomal. So the gene still gets translated into RNA and proteins, but remains separate from the rest of the genome, like a loose leaf of paper slipped into a book without messing up the original text. This minimized cancer risks. For all their benefits, however, adenoviruses suffer one titanic risk. They can cause disease and are thus immunogenic. In other words, they can trigger a big immune response, and this eventually led to a horrific landmark tragedy. In 1999, 18-year-old Jesse Gelsinger signed up for a medical trial held by the University of Pennsylvania. Gelsinger was young and relatively fit, but suffered a mild form of a disease called OTC deficiency. This deficiency affects the body's ability to break down ammonia. If serious, it can be fatal, but since Gelsinger's case was mild, he only had to watch his diet and take some pills. In the trial, Gelsinger received an adenovirus-based gene treatment for the condition. But since the vector transferred less than 1% of the desired genes to the right cells, the people in the trial gave him the highest dose, some 38 trillion virions. The virus had almost all of its genes removed, so it can't replicate, but they are still immunogenic. This and the large dose triggered a massive immune response and multi-organ failure, and he passed away. Serious lapses of human trial protocol, conflict of financial interest, and informed consent were later discovered. Lawsuits were filed. It also largely ended the use of adenoviruses for most all gene therapies in the United States. There are still use for cancer-related gene therapies, vaccines to trigger the immune system to attack tumor cells. Here, their wide applicability and immunogenic status are pluses. The first gene therapy ever approved by a state organization was an adenovirus cancer therapy. In 2003, the People's Republic of China's State Food and Drug Administration approved gendasine for certain head and neck cancers. Neither the US nor EU has approved it. Anyway, in wake of the tragedy, the industry adopted a new set of viral vectors and has renewed a dedication towards safety. First, there were the lentiviruses, which are a subset of the aforementioned retrovirus. HIV is a lentivirus. Due to their small size and ability to generate sustained gene expression, they remain the top choice for therapies where cells are treated outside of the human body before being returned. Lentivirus-based treatments saw great benefit in the treatment of a disease called X-linked adrenoleukodystrophy, or ALD. Characterized by the buildup of fatty acids in the neural system, it can lead to a vegetative state and death. The disease was featured in the 1992 movie Lorenzo's Oil, where two parents fund the research and production of a controversial treatment. In 2007, we had the first gene therapy trials for ALD, and such treatments have been found to be quite promising. The FDA has granted a few such treatments breakthrough status, accelerating their approval. Though since it is a retrovirus, the threat of activating oncogenes remains. So most therapies have moved on towards modified adeno-associated viruses, or AAVs. These very little viruses were first discovered in the 1960s in the wild as contaminants of adenovirus cell lines at various laboratories. Scientists soon realized that the AAV is no ordinary virus. First and foremost, it is very small, about 25 nanometers wide, so they hold far fewer DNA, up to 5,000 bases, though there are newer versions under development offering higher capacities. Due to this tiny size, it cannot replicate without the use of helper functions provided by adjacent adenoviruses, like a parasite to a virusite. It travels with the adenoviruses, but itself has never been seen to cause disease. So the AAV generally does not cause toxicity or immunogenic issues unless repeatedly administered. This general safety perception is why scientists started working with them in the mid-1980s. Moreover, if the AAV can't immediately inject its payload, then it can hang around like a drone, unbothered by the immune system until it can. The first AAV trials in the 1990s targeted the cystic fibrosis gene. However, despite much effort and research, success for that one remains somewhat elusive. So the first AAV-based gene therapy to receive approval was Glybera, which the EU approved in 2012, after three prior rejections, as a treatment for a rare genetic disorder called lipoprotein lipase deficiency. But Glybera gained a great deal of negative press for costing over $1 million and was later withdrawn. Only 31 people ever received the drug. This is a nice on-ramp to our final point, the challenges of manufacturing. Here we will focus on AAVs, since they seem to be the dominant platform in the industry today. There are 200 plus trials in progress for them. but they're applicable to other existing virus vectors like lentiviruses. As I mentioned at the start, the AAV is astoundingly complicated to produce. Since the virus is so stripped down, it cannot replicate without the additional helper functions contributed by a co-infection virus, usually an adenovirus or a herpes simplex virus. Safety-wise, this is a feature, not a bug. It's in line with the industry's general arc towards making gene therapy as safe as possible. Manufacturing-wise, however, this is definitely a problem. We split AAV production into upstream and downstream processes. In the upstream processes, we produce the raw viruses in mass. This is not an easy feat. It requires that we coordinate the expression of over 10 virus genes from both the AAV and the co-infection virus's helper functions. At the same time, we must amplify the therapeutic gene payload accurately and in high volume. Work must be done to ensure that we have enough of all these different components. After that, we assemble these various components together inside host cells, usually an embryonic kidney cell line called HEK293, or insect cells are chosen. We transfect the host cells with our components and then ferment the cells inside bioreactors for 48 to 72 hours. We still do not very well understand how this whole assembly process works inside the host cells, and for that reason, we can't easily optimize said process, so yields remain very low. The majority of what the host cell produces are empty capsids, AAV protein envelopes without genes inside. These guys can't infect. Less than 10,000 complete viruses are produced, a yield of just 5 to 30%. And of those, only a percentage are actually infectious, per a recent paper from 2023. Very disappointing. Once the host cells are finished, we then go into the downstream processes, extracting and purifying the AAVs so that the finished drugs will meet FDA standards of consistent quality, safety, and efficacy. So in downstream, we harvest the host cells. This may require that we lyse them to release the finished AAV particles inside. After that, we filter out impurities like cell debris, empty capsids, host cell DNA strands, and other stuff. This is done using a series of steps that include filters and ultracentrifugation, which involves spinning the vials at over 150,000 revolutions per minute to separate the contents by weight. And then a series of chromatography steps that separate particles by their various properties like their charge, hydrophobicity, and size. Finally, we purify the result and formulate it for stability before sending it to the patient. All of these extensive downstream processes reduce yields even further, but are necessary to ensure that the dose is safe and actually works, because a dose that isn't potent is ruinously expensive. There are a variety of other reasons why gene therapy is so expensive. The regulation is rather rigorous, which makes sense considering the history. The disorders afflict only a small pool of people who may or may not be able to pay, a pool that shrinks if the gene therapy does the job it is created to do. However, the single most significant reason why gene therapies cost $1 million or more, and why many gene therapy companies struggle to turn a profit despite such eye-popping price tags, is because doses cost $300,000 or more to manufacture. And it costs $300,000 to manufacture because each production run yields less than 20% of virus at the end. We can't scale up the batches because we risk losing consistency, so assembling a single dose may require up to a dozen runs or some form of parallelization. Manufacturers are still in search of a viral manufacturing platform that is rapid and provides high throughput. And like semiconductor fabs, they need ways to monitor the quality of the work-in-progress wafers as they travel through said process. Did I say wafers? I mean viruses. People recognize that there is a lot of opportunity, but the strict regulation and conservative nature of the industry makes it hard to adopt new things as they arrive. Yet I doubt the long-term economic sustainability of a $1 to $3 million price tag, so perhaps such changes will soon be forced upon them. All right, everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.